One Minute After You Die by Erwin W. Lutzer. This audio version is published by Oasis Audio through an agreement with Moody Press. One Minute After You Die is read by Erwin W. Lutzer.
You are about to begin listening to a book that has helped tens of thousands of people have a better grasp of existence beyond the grave. Whether comforting or disturbing, these teachings will challenge popular conceptions of life after death. This book has received many different responses. Someone wrote, "I've just finished the book One Minute After You Die, and it has thrilled me. I'm sending for 2 extra copies for my sons who are worried about whether they are ready to die. I know that if they will read this book, they'll know how to be prepared." Another said, "My father is afraid of death, so he always turns your book face down so that he won't have to look at it." Someone else said, "A friend of mine was admitted into a hospital after a suicide attempt. Someone gave him a copy of One Minute After You Die, and he came to trust Christ as Savior. He left the hospital assured of eternal life and with his mind at ease." A few of the topics we'll be covering include such things as an assessment of such phenomena as near-death experiences, reincarnation, and channeling. We'll learn what the Bible teaches about life after death for believers and for unbelievers. What heaven will be like, what will be different, and what will be the same. The biblical doctrine of hell, its rationale, and descriptions of it. Most important, you'll be shown how to be ready when your name is called. Remember, 1 minute after you die, you will be more alive than you have ever been. Join me as we discover what you can expect on the other side. Introduction. Welcome to Eternity. 1 minute after you slip behind the parted curtain, you will either be enjoying a personal welcome from Christ or catching your first glimpse of gloom as you have never known it. Either way, your future will be irrevocably fixed and eternally unchangeable. Every human being, says C.S. Lewis, is in the process of becoming a noble being, noble beyond imagination, or else, alas, a vile being beyond redemption. He exhorts us to remember that the dullest and most uninteresting person you can talk to may one day be a creature which, if you saw it now, you would be strongly tempted to worship, or else a horror and a corruption such as you now meet, if at all, only in a nightmare. There are no ordinary people. It is immortals with whom we joke, we work with, marry, snub, and exploit, immortal horrors or everlasting splendors. Those who find themselves in heaven will be surrounded with friends whom they have known on earth. Friendships once rudely interrupted by death will continue where they left off. Every description of heaven they have ever heard will pale in the light of reality. All this forever. Others, indeed many others, will be shrouded in darkness, a region of deprivation and unending regret. There, with their memories and feelings fully intact, images of their life on earth will return to haunt them. They will think back to their friends, family, and relatives. They will brood over opportunities they squandered and intuitively know that their future is both hopeless and unending. For them, death will be far worse than they ever imagined. And so, my friend, while relatives and friends plan your funeral, deciding on a casket, a burial plot, and who the pallbearer shall be, you will be more alive than you've ever been. You will either see God on his throne, surrounded by angels and redeemed humanity, or you will feel an indescribable weight of guilt and abandonment. There is no destination midway between these 2 extremes, just gladness or gloom. Nor will it be possible to transfer from one region to another. No matter how endless the ages, no matter how heartfelt the cries, No matter how intense the suffering, your travel plans are limited to your present abode. Those who find themselves in the lower gloomy regions shall never enter the gates that lead to endless light and ecstasy. They will discover that the beautiful words spoken in their eulogy bear no resemblance to the reality that now confronts them. If only their friends could see them now. I'm told that there is a cemetery in Indiana that has an old tombstone bearing this epitaph. Pause, stranger, when you pass me by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so you will be. So prepare for death and follow me. An unknown passerby read those words and underneath scratched this reply. To follow you, I'm not content until I know which way you went. In recent days, I've conducted two funerals. The first was that of a Christian woman who had distinguished herself by a life of sacrificial service for Christ. The triumph of the family was striking. There was irrepressible joy mixed with the sorrow. But the second was that of an apparent unbeliever who was killed in a highway accident. The grief of the relatives was marked by desperation and hopelessness. They refused to be comforted. Well, you and I shall follow these two people to the grave. Unless Christ should return in our lifetime, we shall all pass through that iron gate of death, described by Hamlet as the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns. Thinking about our final destination gives us perspective. For a moment, just visualize a measuring tape extending from the earth to the farthest star. Our stay here is but a hairline, almost invisible to the length of the tape. Strictly speaking, no distance can be compared to eternity. No matter how endless we visualize eternity to be, our conception is never endless enough. Every one of us wants to make investments, wise investments, to get the biggest bang for our buck, as the saying goes. The best investments are those that are safe and permanent. And if we are wise, we will spend our time preparing for that which lasts forever. What is life but the preparation for eternity? Recently, I read a tragic story about people enjoying themselves on the top stories of a tall apartment building, not knowing that there was a fire burning on the lower floors. Just so, many are enjoying life, comfortably ignoring the fact that their death is not only inevitable, but much nearer than they thought. Though there are many uncertainties in our lives, we can count on this. Whatever we strive for in this world must of necessity be temporary. Indeed, this world and all that we have accumulated will eventually be burned up. The other day I was browsing in the travel section of a bookstore. Potential travelers were buying maps and guidebooks on Hawaii and Europe. Some were purchasing booklets to help them learn some phrases of a foreign language. No doubt they had saved their money, blocked out their vacation schedules, and purchased airline tickets. All that just for a 2-week journey. I wondered how many of them were giving at least that much attention to their final destination. I wondered how many were reading the guidebook, studying the map, or trying to learn the language of heaven. Europe and Hawaii seemed so much more real than the unseen realm of the dead. And yet, even as they planned their vacations, they were en route to a more distant destination. The purpose of this book is to study what the Bible has to say about the life beyond. Many who read it will be comforted, others will be disturbed, and everyone, I hope, will be instructed. I claim no special revelation, just a desire to accurately explain what the Bible has to say. So I pray that God will help me make heaven so inviting that those who are ready to enter will scarcely be able to wait. But I also pray that I shall make hell so fearsome that those who are not yet ready to die shall quickly come to trust the only one who can shield them from the wrath to come. Death, our enemy, can be our friend when God gives us the final.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.